still practicing in South Africa, there was a statute of limitations in all cases other than murder. In the case of murder, there wasn't. Now, if in the Biko case, some of the younger policemen may still be alive, although it was what now? It was 40 years ago. One of the other problems that arises from it is that some of the evidence, say I'm thinking of the Biko case, but not only that case, so some of the evidence that was relevant to it was given when people like the police concerned were interviewed for the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. But as far as I remember, it was a term of the law which set up the commission, which required them to answer, but said that any answers they give could not be used against them in other proceedings. The nationalist government, the apartheid government, set out to put more Afrikaans speakers on the judiciary, where they had been, you know, in numerical terms underrepresented. But that required them to make a large number of purely of political appointments, which in the eyes of the practicing profession were purely political in the sense that no one could discern any qualification that they had for the judiciary other than their politics. But at the same time, you know, they had to keep things going, a lot of commercial work, a lot of other work, and so there were always some judges who were appointed on merit. The other thing about it is that some of the political appointments turned out to be absolutely straight and independent. So unless you were very unlucky, you know, you had a chance before those judges. But there's no doubt that the political appointments reduced the overall competence of the judiciary. Now you ask what I think of the position now. I've heard a lot from, you know, old friends of mine who still practice at the bar in South Africa, and I've read some reports and so on. And there's no doubt at all that the overall competence of the bench has been diminished. But she started with the idea, and she got the funding. She went to New York, and somehow, I still don't know how, she got the three major charitable foundations, Ford, Rockefeller, and Carnegie, to fund it. She also got some money from Harry Oppenheimer, and the next thing she did was persuade Arthur Chaskelson to give up most of his practice at the bar to be full-time at the LRC. In my years as a senior counsel in South Africa, I felt I usually knew more law than the judge. When I came to England, I didn't. One of the differences was really appearing before absolutely first-rate judges. I found I was more often, in England, I was more often on the same wavelength as the judge than I had been in South Africa. The best English judge I ever appeared before was Lord Bingham. Mm. And tremendous intellect, great knowledge of the law, wonderful way of expressing himself, and a listener. I mean, he would listen to arguments. He wouldn't have he'd ask questions, but he did really have as open a mind as you could expect.